How's it going, everybody? Dotodoya here with another Dragon Ball FighterZ video. And this time around, we're going to be doing something more tutorial-like, and we're going to be talking about something that's a very core component of both Dragon Ball FighterZ and other fighting games. That thing being conditioning your opponent. Now, admittedly, conditioning your opponent is very intrinsic to the fighting game experience, so even if you haven't had somebody explain it to you, if you've been playing long enough, you've probably figured it out yourself. Basically, conditioning your opponent in a fighting game is the exact same as conditioning anything else in life. You're doing something very specific to your opponent so that they can react and you can sort of control what the outcome of that situation is going to be. To put it directly in Dragon Ball FighterZ terms, let's say you have your opponent in the corner, this is the first time of the game, you go instant air dash overhead. They get hit by it the first time or they block it. That doesn't really matter. What matters is that they see that you went for an instant air dash overhead and that you did click a button to attack. So the next time you get in this situation, you again go instant air dash overhead. This time they block it, probably, unless they're super bad and they get hit by it again. Regardless, it doesn't matter because at this point, he should be getting the idea that when you're in the corner, instant air dashing into an overhead is your general go-to plan. And then on the third or fourth time you have them in the corner and you go for an instant airhead, maybe this time you whiff it and go for a low, it'll catch them completely off guard as they were expecting to block an overhead. Now, admittedly, this is a super basic example, but conditioning goes for everything, whether it be, you know, a crazy sort of character-specific gimmick, something like a Cell True 50-50, or a really awkward assist setup. This is why fighting game tournaments are usually run on a best-to-three sort of system, because the tournament isn't only testing your ability on how good you are at a one-player type of game and reactionary defense, it's also testing how well you're able to adapt to your opponent's playstyles and their gimmicks, as well as trying to condition them yourselves. This is why it's also a common rule in fighting game tournaments that if you win a game, you can't switch off characters, only the person that loses can switch off characters, because it's trying to prohibit people from hitting you with a gimmick one time, and then as soon as you lose a game, switch characters, now it's time to hit you with a different gimmick. Now, one thing that I really do want to stress before we move on to some more examples from upper mid levels of Dragon Ball FighterZ is that if you are a total beginner to this game and are just in the beginning ranks, do not try to condition your opponent. I promise you, that's the beginner's luck of fighting games. It's not really luck at all. It's just the fact that people who play a lot of fighting games usually expect their opponents to react in a certain way to things. But beginners, you know, they're just gonna do what they want to do. So, just a small caveat, if you're new to fighters, just always go for a media attack. I promise you, that will be a much better strategy until you get up to the mid-level. But anyway, now we can very quickly get into some real match examples. Quick little note here, this footage comes from a first to den I did against Lotus on the Omega Pro Weekly stream, which, by the way, you should go follow both of those guys. They both produce very good quality Dragon Ball FighterZ content, as well as a lot of stuff for a lot of other games. Links will be down in the description. But what we're going to focus on here in the gameplay is that you'll see after I get a sliding knockdown on Lotus, I go to chase his tech and then go in for an instant air dash overhead. Now, this is the first time I've done this throughout the set, so what happens here isn't that important to me. I'm more so looking to what his response is going to be. And you'll see here when he does get up, he goes for the reflect, which instantly pushes me back off, and the situation has been reset into neutral. So after a couple more times of me going for that instant overhead and getting reflected, it's gotten to the point where I've gotten another sliding knockdown, and this is the part of the game where I'm going to cash in on all of that conditioning. I'm going to go for an air dash in, but I'm just going to land and go for a Dragon Rush to completely negate that Wake Up Reflect, and you see it does go my way here. And I think I get this exact same result maybe one or two more times, but part of the fun of playing a good opponent like Lotus is that he's not going to just stop there. The match is obviously going to continue, so he's going to switch up what he does on Wake Up. So you'll see now at the very end of the set, Lotus is going to just, instead of reflecting, he's just going to jump back, get out of there. So essentially, he's just found another way to get the situation back into neutral. Now, this was towards the end of the set, and I never really did figure out how I wanted to deal with that, so that's pretty much where this scenario ends. But the overall timeline for this basically went: get the sliding knockdown, instant overhead into reflect one or two more times, instant air dash overhead into landing into the Dragon Rush, into Lotus jumping back. And although I don't have any footage of it, another area where conditioning can be used is in your character's block strings, and for this example we are going to use Bardock. So normally Bardock's block string would look something like this. It leaves him pretty safe, but there are parts in the block string where if you want to take a risk and you've conditioned the opponent to sit there for this entire block string, you could either throw in some low lights and stagger your buttons, or you could go for one of Bardock's specials, charges it up, and if it lands — this move takes a long time to charge, by the way — then you're once again positive on block, and you can go back into another block string. This is obviously good because it keeps your block strings fresh, and it keeps your opponent on their toes, and it just gets you more block pressure. So, win, win, win. So basically, I could go on, you know, with every character and do some gimmicks and how that conditions opponents, but it's basically the same throughout the entire cast. You're just doing something to try and elicit a response from your opponent that you can carefully plan for and then punish. Like I said at the beginning, this video is more made for beginners totally new to the fighting game genre or just jumping into an online fighting game for the very first time. Hopefully it really helped you guys out, and if it did, please let me know down in the comments, and also make sure to let me know how new you are to Dragon Ball FighterZ as well. If you just have any other questions, you can ask them down there as well. I'll be down there as always. While you're down there though, if you like this channel and these tutorial videos, make sure to leave a like and subscribe. I really do appreciate it, and it really helps the channel. As always, I'm Dotodoya, and I'll see you in the next video.